Okay, so let us look at the hierarchy of organisms. So if we see the different levels in the organization, the different levels in the classification, so we can observe the hierarchy. So by looking at the hierarchy, we will understand that at the higher level in the hierarchy, there will be so many organisms, means the higher category will be a very large category with very large number of animals, which are having many differences and less similarities. Say for example, here let us see that life begins with life, and under the life there are domains. So domain is a very big category with organisms that have so many differences and less similarities. So under the domain we may have kingdom. Example, plant kingdom, Plantae. If you take Plantae, under Plantae there are so many plants. There is a lot of variation. The differences are more among the plants when compared to the similarities under this Plantae category. So in the hierarchy, the higher categories, in the higher categories, the category will be very large. It will have more number of organisms, more differences, less similarities. And below kingdom, here is the phylum. Below phylum, class. Below class, order. Below order, family. Below family, genus. And below the genus, species. Species. So this is the hierarchy of organisms. Species, if you see the species, a species will have a different organisms. The species will have the same kind of organisms with less differences and more similarities. If you take a species, Homo sapiens, humans, Homo sapiens. If you take Homo sapiens, similarities are more when compared to the differences. If you go up, genus, okay, similarities are more when compared to the differences, but less similarities than species. If you go higher, if you go to family, if you go to order, if you go to class, what happens? So the similarities decreases, differences increases. So if you go to the higher category, differences are more, similarities are less. So this is the hierarchy: life, domain, kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, and species. So now we are going to talk about the different kingdoms according to Thomas Whittaker classification of organisms. So he has given five kingdoms: Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, Animalia. So the first one we are going to discuss about is Monera. So in this Monera kingdom, the single-celled organisms are included in this. So they are all single-celled. How are they? Their nature is prokaryotic. So prokaryotic in the sense that they don't have a distinct nucleus. So they do not have a distinct nucleus. Their nucleus is not covered by any nuclear membrane. So that is the main characteristic feature of the Monera organism. So they are single cell, they live with a single cell throughout their life. And if you see their characteristics, their life features, Monerans, they absorb the nutrients from their surroundings. Directly they absorb the nutrients from their surroundings. And how do they reproduce? The Monerans reproduce by splitting. By dividing that single cell into two. So by this process they split. So that is the mode of reproduction in case of these Monerans. And the organisms in this case, they have special kind of structures on their surface called as having some kind of flagella. Certain bacteria will be having a flagella. And certain organisms, certain bacteria may be having cilia. So they help in their locomotion or in their reproduction or whatever. So in other process, these additional structures help them. So we find cilia and flagella in case of the bacteria. So in this Monera, the example for Monera is bacteria. So these bacteria, here I have given the examples. These bacteria, they move. The locomotion is possible because of the extra structures like this flagella and cilia. Okay, so the major groups of organisms that come under this Monera, what are the major groups? Let us see. They are Archaebacteria, Eubacteria, Cyanobacteria. So Archaebacteria, what are these Archaebacteria? These are the very ancient bacteria that are living till date, which are found in the hot springs at very extreme and high temperatures. So those kind of bacteria come into this group, Archaebacteria. And Eubacteria, it comes Streptococcus or E. coli. So these are the examples of Eubacteria and Cyanobacteria. So in this case, in this group, we get blue-green bacteria. So these the blue-green bacteria are similar to blue-green algae, but it is a different. Blue-green algae is different from blue-green bacteria. So these are the cyanobacteria. These three are the major groups under this Monera. So the Monerans, they are not very harmful organisms. So in most of the cases, they may be useful to us also. So this is the Monera. The second one is Protista. So let us look at the second kingdom, that is the Protista. So in Protista, we find mostly unicellular organisms. So only a few have more number of cells, but mostly most of them unicellular organisms, and the cell is having distinct nucleus. So the main feature, distinct nucleus, that means the nucleus will be having a membrane. The nucleus is covered by membrane, and of course the cell organelles are also seen in some cases. And their mode of nutrition, that they feed on other organisms or food particles that present around them, and organisms in certain Protista, they prepare their own food. So they feed on other organisms. Examples: paramecium feed on other organisms. Paramecium belongs to Protista. It feed on other organisms, whereas organisms like Protist, like Euglena, it prepares its own food. So both are found in this Protista. Some organisms, they prepare their own food. Some organisms, they feed on the other organisms. And their mode of reproduction is splitting. Splitting way, they have a fission, binary fission. Binary fission is seen among this Euglena or Paramecium. So that is their mode of reproduction. They reproduce. So they will be having some special cell organelles also. So that is the other thing. We see they have locomotory organs. Amoeba is having pseudopodia for movement, that is for locomotion. It uses it for capture the food as well, amoeba. And if you see that Euglena, it will be like this. This Euglena will be having a flagella. This whip-like structure, flagella, that is useful for its locomotion. And paramecium is a slipper animalcule. Looks like a sole of a slipper. So this paramecium will be having cilia on its body surface for its locomotion. So these are the characteristic features of this protista. So the examples are amoeba, paramecium, and euglena. So the third kingdom, it is fungi. So in case of fungi, we find unicellular fungi like yeast, and we find multicellular having some number of certain number of cells like bread mold, and we see the other fungi, multicellular fungi which is big enough and having a prominent head-like structure, mushrooms. So these are the examples of fungi. Now let us see what are the characteristics of fungi. Fungi are multicellular and unicellular. Certain fungi are unicellular. So the unicellular fungi is yeast, only the yeast. Remaining are multicellular. Most of the fungi are multicellular, having more number of cells. Only the yeast is having a single cell. So that is the one characteristic feature. And the second characteristic feature of certain fungi like mushroom, they have a distinct head. Head-like differentiation. So these are the eukaryotes which is showing some kind of differentiation, looking like some having a body with a head, a different distinction is found there. And these yeast, they cannot prepare their food, but they depend upon the decaying organic matter. So any organic matter is decayed, on that organic matter these organisms, they feed on the bread mold. We see the mold on fruits and the bread and the food which is a stale food, we can find this mold. And in case of mushrooms also, we can see on the wet damp areas, that is on the bark of the tree, we find this mushrooms. So these organisms, these mushrooms have some special structures, root like structures, but those are not roots. So with the help of the special structures, they absorb the nutrients from the environment. For example, if you see the mushroom on the trunk of a tree, bark of a tree, so from that bark, the decaying part, any decaying part is there, from that the organic materials are absorbed. So these fungi, they break down the organic materials in the environment and they use that nutrients. So here yeast is the unicellular organism. These organisms like yeast, it reproduces by a process known as budding. So budding is a method of reproduction in yeast that is seen in that fungi. But whereas in the other fungi, other members like bread mold and mushrooms, in these cases there is no budding. In these cases we find like spores. Forming some spores. So these spores are just like seeds of a plant. So the spores are spread from one place to another place, and there the birth of the new fungi takes place. So in this way it propagates, it reproduces by the method of sporulation and by budding. So this is about the fungi. So we learned about Monera, Protista and fungi. Next we move to that plantae, plant kingdom, and we see the different types of plants are how they are classified in plant kingdom. Okay, so we're going to talk about the kingdom plantae. So into this kingdom, all the plants in this world come into this plantae kingdom. So the plants are so diverse. We see different types of plants and trees around us. Their shapes, their sizes, we find difference in their fruit, in their flower, in their stem, in their root, in their branching. So there are so many differences among the plants, and it is a very big category where huge number of organisms are classified. So how the classification of plants has taken place in this plant kingdom. So here the classification of plants goes on by comparing their features, external characteristics, whether what is the shape of the plant, the classification may be based on the size, the mode, the food obtained, their reproductive structures, how they are reproducing, what kind of seeds they are producing, whether they are producing seeds or not, or any other means. So there are so many ways by which the classification of plants takes place. Here the classification of plantae into different classes or families or genus taken place based upon their complexity. So whether the differentiation is there or not. So in this, the first thing they it is considered is that differentiation. That is whether the plant has got distinct body parts or not. Distinct body parts. That means whether it is having a stem, root, branch, leaf or not. Or just it is having a simple structure just like some mushroom or something. Distinct part. Distinct body parts. And second thing, whether they have any differentiated tissues. Different types of tissues. So in the primary forms of organisms, they will be having only one cell or few cells. That's all. They won't be having different kinds of tissues. So second thing is tissues. Depending upon the different kind of tissues they have, the classification goes. And the next thing, differentiation. In their method of the third one here considered is that the mode of reproduction, whether they are producing seeds or not, whether they are flowering or not. So this is the third thing taken here, reproduction. So now let us see, on basing these characteristics, on basing these differences, how the plants are classified. So we have seen the first level of classification in plants is based upon that they have a different distinct body parts or not. They have leaves, stem, root, that kind of differentiation is there or not. And second thing, the differentiation in the tissues is existing or not. And the way they are reproducing, whether they are producing seeds or not, whether they are bearing the seeds or not. So these are the different things on basing that the categorization goes on. So if we observe some small and simple plants that are found on the moist and damp places, that is on the moist rocks, we find some green color carpet like small plants that are forming a carpet like one. We call it as moss plants. They are very tiny plants. So if you scrap any stone that has got moss or with a slide, and if you observe it under microscope, you will be finding the small plant like structures, green colored structures having like this. So they'll be having very simple body. The body is not differentiated into stem, root or whatever. So it's very simple. There is no distinction in their parts. So there is no differentiation. And moreover, in their mode of reproduction, we find very small structures similar to seeds, but those are not seeds. Because the moss, they do not bear any flowers to bear the seeds. You know that the flower changes to fruit and fruit contains the seed. But here they do not bear any flowers. But how these spores are formed? The spores are formed in a special structure called as sporangium. So in sporangium, the spores are formed. They are similar to seeds, but they are not seeds. So that mode of reproduction is seen in the moss. And even if you see a fern, ferns are also very simple plants which are having leaves, and at the edges of the leaf you find some spores, ferns. So ferns and mosses, they do not bear any flowers. They are very simple plants. So these kind of plants that do not bear flowers are called as cryptogams. Cryptogams do not bear flowers. No flowers. So no flowers, no seeds. So the plants that bear flowers, like pine, like cycas, like mango, so these are all like banana, these are all the plants or trees that bear the flowers, are called phanerogams. Plants that bear flowers. These are phanerogams. So here we have seen that plants are divided to cryptogams, phanerogams. So cryptogams are the organisms, those are the plants that do not bear any flowers or any seeds. So they bear the spores for their reproduction, and their bodies are very simple and not very well differentiated. So the cryptogams are again classified into bryophyta, pteridophyta. So bryophyta and pteridophyta. So the difference is here they don't have the very distinct leaves or roots. Here they have true roots and true leaves. So they don't have true roots or leaves in this case. So they have this. So phanerogams, what are phanerogams? Phanerogams are the plants that bear the flowers and that bear the seeds. In the phanerogams, again, there are two types. They are gymnosperms and angiosperms. Angiosperms, gymnosperms. So what are these gymnosperms and what are these angiosperms? Angiosperms means the plants that have their seeds enclosed in a fruit. See mango. If you see a mango, where is the seed? Inside the mango fruit. You have to cut the mango fruit to get the seed. So that is called as an angiosperm. The plants that have seeds enclosed by a fruit are angiosperms. Example, mango and see gram, Bengal gram or peas. So these are all angiosperms in which the seed is enclosed by a fruit. In case of gymnosperms, the seeds are open. They are not enclosed by any fruit. Example, pine. In case of a pine, you will find a cone. The seeds are attached to the cone, that's all. They don't have any fruit enclosing the seeds. So those are the gymnosperms and these are the angiosperms. And if you see that the angiosperms are again divided into two different categories. They are the monocot and dicot. So depending upon the number of cotyledons. So the plants that have a single cotyledon in their seed are monocots. The plants that have two cotyledons in their seed are called dicots. So we have seen the previous activities. So this is the way how a plant kingdom is classified. Plants to cryptogams and phanerogams. Cryptogams to bryophyta and pteridophyta. In bryophyta, they do not have a developed or a distinct true root and leaves. In pteridophyta, they have some true roots and true leaf structures in pteridophyta. And whereas in phanerogams, so phanerogams, again, two categories, angiosperms and gymnosperms. Angiosperms are the plants that have seeds enclosed in a fruit, and gymnosperms, the seeds are out, naked seeds, gymnosperms. And again, the angiosperms are divided to monocot and dicot depending upon the number of cotyledons inside the seed. If seed is having one cotyledon, it is a monocot, and seed is having two cotyledons, it is a dicot. Examples of monocot, all grass plants like rice, wheat, so jowar, bajra, whatever the grass plants, cereal plants, all are monocots. And dicot examples, all the pulses like Bengal gram, green gram. So these are the dicot. We will come to know whether it is a dicot or a monocot just by observing the seed. If you find two cotyledons, it is a dicot. If you see only one cotyledon, it is a monocot. So this is the classification of plant kingdom. So now we are going to talk about the classification of animals, animal kingdom. So we have seen about Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae. Now we have come to Animalia, Animal Kingdom. So in this animal kingdom, there are number of animals which are categorized according to the differences and similarities that they have. So in this animal kingdom, the animals are multinuclear, all the animals. Let us look at the basic similarities among the members of this group animals. All animals are multicellular. And they are heterotrophic in nutrition. So they are multicellular organisms and they are heterotrophic. So that means they take their food from other organisms, either plants or animals. So all animals are dependent on other animals or plants for their food. So that is the animal kingdom. So in this animal kingdom, depending upon their body complexity, so they are classified into different phylums. Let us see the phylum. The first phylum, we see the Porifera. So in this phylum Porifera, we see animals like Euplectalia. So Euplectalia, Cycon, Spongelia, these are the examples of the Poriferans. So Poriferans like sponges are the best examples of Porifera. So they have a very simple body, undifferentiated body, and these organisms are fixed, sedentary. So they are fixed at one place. Most of the animals, we have seen the similarities among the animals. Animals, they move from one place to another place, and animals, they are heterotrophic in nature, and animals are multinucleated. They have multicellular. The animals are multicellular organisms. So these common characteristics here, but these animals are not having the characteristic of moving. They are fixed, they are the having a fixed characteristic. So they are not mobile. They don't move from one place to another place. So why they have got this name Porifera, this phylum Porifera? These organisms have pores on their body surface. So these pores are connected to the canal system which is present inside its body. So as they are having pores, it is called as Porifera. So these Poriferans are marine in nature habitat, that they live in the salt water, that is on the floor, or they are fixed to some surface like some rock in the water. So along with the water current, some kind of organisms enter into the pores, into the body of the sponges. So those organisms are captured and used as a food, and even oxygen also collected from the water that passes through the canal system, that is through the pores of these sponges. So the examples, Euplectalia and Cycon, Spongelia, these kind of sponges are examples of the phylum Porifera.